Okay, so I'm now recording. Okay, so as a reminder, test one is on November 9th during class on Zoom, and review for test one is on November 4th during class. Okay, so we're covering review later this class, okay? So right now, any questions about homework? 3.2, 1 or 9? Okay, no questions. Okay, so good, we have a lot to do. Okay, so at the end of last class, I'm going to bring up last class. So we started with 3.2, a norm, dot product, and distance, right? So I defined the norm of a vector, properties of the norm. You know, somewhere around there. So it'll be in a little bit. Okay, so... okay, then I talked about the standard unit vectors in R2 and R3. So then I talked about the distance between two vectors, right? The norm of u minus v. The definition of dot product u dot v is equal to norm of u times norm of v times cosine theta. Three cases, depending on whether u dot v is positive, negative, or zero. Then the theta, the angle between them, satisfies cosine theta is either positive, negative, or zero. Well, theta is acute, obtuse, or right angle. Okay, so we've covered a lot of theorems. The Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, we went over that. The triangle inequality for vectors and for distances. Okay, and then we ended class with, so we talked about a normal of a line or plane. Right, saying that a normal to a line or plane satisfies this equation where the dot product of the norm vector and any vector p dot p on the line or plane is equal to zero. Okay, and we had an expression for p dot p in both a line and a plane. So then we can rewrite equation one, where this is equation one, the dot product between the norm and array as a vector as being this for a line and this for a plane. So these are called the point normal equations of the line and plane. So I'm going to start class off with our examples of these equations. Okay, so examples of lines and planes in point normal form. In point normal. Okay, so for instance, let's say in R2, so let's say you're living in R2 and you want to talk about the line through the point 3 comma negative 7 with normal vector 6 comma 1. Okay, so it's a line through this point and with that normal vector. So what does that mean? It's a line through this point with that normal vector. So if we want to visualize what this is, the line through that point, that normal vector, then let's say you have a point. So let's say you had the point 3 comma negative 7. This was 3 and this was negative 7. You want to line with normal 6 comma 1. Well, 6 comma 1 would mean you move to the right 6 and up 1. So let's say your normal vector was here, right? Where the x distance was 6 and the y distance was 1. So this would represent the vector 6 comma 1. As a normal, this vector is perpendicular to this line. It's normal to this line I want to draw. So if you imagine what this line might look like, it's a line that's perpendicular to that vector. It could look something like this, except going through that point. Something like this. So this is a line that's perpendicular to this normal vector through that given point that I labeled with this black dot. Okay, it's not going through 3, it's just to the left of 3. Okay, so 3 is 3 is more to the side here. Okay, so 3 is like there, and it's to the side of it. Okay, so this would be a line like that. Now, the way we described it in class was you can express it as the dot product of n dot vector p dot p, where p dot is any point, fixed point on the line. This point given to you is your p dot. So p dot is equal to this 3 comma negative 7 point. And p is an arbitrary point. This p would be an arbitrary point x comma y on your line. So p is the arbitrary point whose coordinates are x comma y. So we want n dot p dot p to equal 0. The dot product of any vector from p dot to p, a vector like this, this would be a vector p dot p. The dot product between that blue vector and that pink one would be 0, right? And they form a right angle with each other, which means that their dot product has to be 0, okay? So the normal vector is 6, 1. So 6 times x minus 3 plus 1 times y minus negative 7 is equal to 0, okay? Okay, so what we're doing is we're saying if n is the vector whose components are n1 comma n2, then you have n1 times x minus x1 minus n minus x minus x0 plus n2 times x minus y0. Is equal to 0. X naught comma y naught are the coordinates of p naught. And the coordinates of p is x comma y. The vector p naught p is equal to x minus x naught comma y minus y naught. So you're dot producting that vector with the vector n, which is n1 comma n2, right? I already wrote that earlier. N is n1 comma n2. I'm just using that notation. So the dot product of n dotted with p dot p is equal to, well, we're saying it's 0, but n dotted with p dot p is equal to the first component, n1, times the first component, x minus x naught, plus the second component, n2, times the second component, y minus y naught. Okay, so that's what this equation is right here. I'm writing n times p dot p is equal to 0. The left side is the dot product n times p dot dotted with p dot p, and the right side is saying equals 0. And so we have an equation of this line. It's that equation I wrote right there. So the equation, we're expressing it as n dotted with p dot P right, but that's equal to, so this is equal to 0, we're saying. That's how you express it. N dot with p dot p is the dot product of n, the coordinates of the normal vector, which is n1 comma n2, and then dotted with the coordinates of p dot p, which are x minus x naught comma y minus y naught. And so this is equal to 6 comma 1 dotted with x minus 3 comma y minus negative 7. And so this is equal to, okay, this is equal to 6 times the first coordinate.
Progress.
6 times x minus 3 plus the second coordinates multiplied 1 times y plus 7. Y minus negative 7 is y plus 7. And so our final expression of that plane, of that line, is 6 times x minus 3 plus 1 times y plus 7 is equal to 0. So this is an expression of the line in R2 through that point with that normal vector. So for R3, let's say you want the line through the points, not the line, the plane through the points 307 with normal n equal to 4, 2, -5. And so the way you express that, again, is through the same equation, n die with p naught is equal to 0. And so then n is the vector 4, 2, -5. And then you dot it with the vector p naught p, which is x minus 3, comma y minus 0, comma z minus 7. And so when you dot those two vectors, you get 4 times x minus 3 plus 2 times y minus 0 plus or minus 5 times z minus 7. That equals 0. So what you get is, if you multiply this out, you get 4x plus 2y minus 5z, and then you get a minus 12 plus 0 plus 35. That's plus 23. One way is to write it is with the numbers equals that. So you know, we'll keep it in this form. That would be an equation of it, but we'll keep it in this form. So we're going to write it like this for now, and equals 0. Okay, so there you go. The coefficients are the components of the normal vector. And then the things you're subtracting, 3, 0, and 7, is the point. It's the fixed point in the plane. Okay. Notice there's three things here, three unknowns because you're talking about a plane. Here there are two unknowns because you're talking about a line. Oh, no, sorry. There's three unknowns because we're living in R3. There's two unknowns because we're living in a line. Okay. So next is theorem 3.3.1, which says A, if A and B are constants, not both zero, okay? Then AX plus BY plus C equals 0 represents a line in R2 with normal N equals A comma B. So if A and B are both constants, they're not equal to 0, then AX plus BY plus C equals 0 represents a line in R2 whose normal vector is A comma B. If A, B, C are constants, not all 0. So two of them could be 0, just not all 3. Then the equation AX plus BY plus CZ plus D equals 0. Represents a plane in R3 with normal n is equal to a comma b comma c. Okay, so if a, b, c are constants, not all three equal to 0, then ax plus by plus c, c plus d equals 0 represents a plane in R3 with normal vector with components a, b, c. Okay, so now let's look at this equation, n dotted with x equals 0. Okay, so where little n is a vector of coefficients and x is a vector of unknowns. So where little n is a vector of coefficients and x is a vector of unknowns. So in R2, in two space, that equation, n dot with x equals 0, that equation is called the vector form of a line through the origin. In R3, that equation is called the vector form of a plane through the origin. Okay, so n dot x equals 0 is the equation called the vector form of a line through the origin. And in R3, it's the vector form of a plane through the origin. Okay. So next is a new thought. How to decompose a vector U into a sum of two orthogonal vectors, meaning perpendicular vectors, the first being a scalar multiple of arbitrary vector A. And the second being orthogonal to A. Okay, so I'm talking about this vector A here. I'm going to bold it so you can see that I'm not using the word A, I'm using vector A. Okay, so to illustrate this, I'm going to go to the whiteboard. Okay, so so let's say you have a vector U, and so let's say you have a vector A that looks like this. That's vector A. I want to decompose U into a sum of two orthogonal or perpendicular vectors such that one is a scalar multiple of this vector A and the other one is orthogonal to that vector. Here's the solution. We have this vector and I call it W1. W1 is a vector that's a scalar multiple of A, and W2 that's a straight line. This is W2. And this is a vector that goes vertically upward like that. Notice how W1 and W2 are orthogonal to each other. They both start at the point Q. Everything starts at this point Q. And if you add W1 plus W2, you get U. So now I can think of U as equaling to W1 plus W2, where W1 is a constant multiple of this vector A, and W2 is perpendicular to W1, and they add up to U. I've decomposed U into a sum of two orthogonal vectors, the first being a scalar multiple of A, and the second being orthogonal to A. So, okay, so W2 is orthogonal to A is the same as being orthogonal to W1, because W1 is a constant multiple of A, right? But I guess you would say W2 is orthogonal to A. So W1 is a scalar multiple of A, and W2 is orthogonal to A. And W1 plus W2 equals U. Okay, so that's how, that's an example of it. So three steps to do this. So I'm gonna write the steps here, underneath here. Okay, so three steps to do this, to decompose U into a sum of two orthogonal vectors, W1 and W2, so that W1 is a scalar multiple of A, and W2 is orthogonal to A. So step one is drop a perpendicular from the tip of U to the line through A. Step two is construct the vector W1 from Q to the foot of the perpendicular. And step three is construct the vector W2 which is equal to u minus w1. Okay, so step one is drop a perpendicular from the tip of u to the line through A. Drop a perpendicular from the tip of u to the line through A. That's what I did here. This was this step here. Drop a perpendicular, this perpendicular, from the tip of u through the line through A. So that thing was, that was the perpendicular right here, right? That was step one, dropping this perpendicular. Okay, step two is construct the vector w1 from q to the foot of the perpendicular. So w1 is the vector from q to the foot of that perpendicular. So from q to the foot of the perpendicular, this is the foot of the perpendicular. Like you have a foot on the ground, right? So you stand on your feet. So this perpendicular is in a sense standing on the vector A. So the foot of the perpendicular is the point where that line touches the line A. So the foot is at the bottom point there. So the foot of the perpendicular is at the end of this the vector called W1. It started at the point Q and ended at the foot of the perpendicular. So constructing W1 was step two. Constructing W1 as the vector from this fixed point Q to the foot of that perpendicular I made in step one. So step two, I now have W1. And then step three is construct the vector W2 is equal to U minus W1. So if I take U, which is this vector, and I subtract W1, which is this vector, W2 is equal to U minus W1. That's step three. So if I take though U and I subtract W1, this is U, and then I subtract W1, adding negative W1. This is U. And that's negative W1. If I add them, or U minus W1, then I get W2, which is U minus W1. So see how this is W2 right here. It's just U minus W1. This is minus W1 here. That would bring me there, right? So construct that step three. Step one is drawing this perpendicular. Step two is making W1. And step three is making W2. Okay, so to sum up, I'm going to do the exact same construction again here, just after I said all the steps. So here's A, right? Here's A. Here's the point Q. This is the vector U, okay? Step one is construct the perpendicular from U to the line A. Here's the perpendicular, so step one. Step two is construct the vector W1. Construct the vector W1 from Q to the foot of the perpendicular. So here, so the arrow stops here. So I construct W1 from Q to the foot of the perpendicular. That's step two. And then step three is W2 is U minus W1. So U minus W1 would be, well, this would be negative W1, this vector right here. So U plus, U minus W1 is the same as U plus negative W1. So if I go from Q to the end of U, and then from the tip of U, I add negative W, then I get W2. So W2 is this vector here. So that's W2, and that's step three, and that's done. So at the end of step three, I have both W1 and W2, where W1 is a constant multiple of A, W2 is orthogonal to A, and U is equal to W1 plus W2. I've decomposed U as a sum of two vectors with those properties, W1 and W2. Okay, so those three steps do that. Any questions about that? Okay, so next is theorem 3.3.2 called the projection theorem. Okay, so if U and V are vectors in N space, and if A is non-zero, then U can be expressed in exactly one way in the form U equals W1 plus W2, where W1 is a scalar multiple of A, and W2 is orthogonal to A. All right? So that's called a projection theorem. If U and V are vectors in N space and A is non-zero, then U can be expressed, if U and A are vectors in N space and A is non-zero, A is a non-zero vector, then U can be expressed in exactly one way in the form U equals W1 plus W2, where W1 is a scalar multiple of A and W2 is orthogonal to A. Okay, so this W1, if we look at, if we go back here, W1, I'm going to leave out the steps to doing this, so that I can talk about the vectors involved themselves. So here's U, this is W1, and this is W2, right? W1 plus W2 is equal to U. Okay, so the W1 here, W1 is called the projection of U onto A. Okay, so it's a projection of this vector U onto A. And it's equal to U dotted with A divided by the norm of A squared. I'm going to write this on the whiteboard, times A. Okay, it's a vector component of U along A. Okay, so this is the vector component of U along A. That's W1. W2 is equal to U minus W1, right? But U minus W1 is the projection, U minus the projection of U onto A. So this is equal to U minus that weird expression there, U minus U dotted with A, that's a U, divided by the norm of A squared, A. And so this is the vector component of U orthogonal to A. Okay, so W1 is the vector component of U along A, and W2 is the vector component of U orthogonal to A. And you can express them with these expressions. So I'm going to write this on the whiteboard. So W1 that I wrote there is equal to the projection along A of U, projection of U along A, which is equal to U dot with A divided by norm of A squared times A, okay? And so this is the vector component of U along A. W2 is equal to U minus W1, which is equal to U minus that expression I just wrote here, which is W1. And this is the vector component of U orthogonal to A. Okay, so that's W1 and W2, the components of the vector U. So example 5. Okay, let U equal to the vector 2, negative 1, 3. And A equal to the vector 4, negative 1, 2. Find the vector component of U along A and the vector component of U orthogonal to A. Okay, so we want to find W1 and W2 for this example. So you just plug into the expression. So W1 is the vector component of U along A, and that's equal to this expression. So then this is equal to, well, U dot with A is this vector dotted with this vector divided by the norm of A, which is this vector, squared times that vector. Okay, so I'm just plugging in there. So the numerator is the dot product of those two vectors. Numerator, right? So you just multiply the corresponding components and add. So it's 8 plus 1 plus 6, right? That's the dot product of those two vectors. 2 times 4 plus -1 times -1 plus 3 times 2. So it's 8 plus 1 plus 6. The denominator is the norm of that vector squared. So the norm is the square root of the sum of the squares. So the square of that is the sum of the squares. This is 4 squared plus negative 1 squared plus 2 squared, right? The norm is the square root of that sum. So I'm just going to write every step here. So that's the norm, the square root of that quantity, right? So the square root of that quantity is the norm. But now you square it, right? So you're taking the square root of the square. Square and rooting and squaring, so that cancels. So the numerator is 8 plus 1 plus 6. And the denominator is that sum. So you get 4 squared plus 1 squared plus 2 squared. But it's also times this vector, right? So we have on the right side, I did the fraction part. So I did the fraction part. So that's equal times that vector. So the numerator is 15. The denominator is 16, 17, 21. And the vector is still the same. That's the vector. So now you multiply that vector by 15 over 21. Well, 15 over 21 is 5/7. So I'm just simplifying that fraction first. Now, multiply the components by 5/7. So you get 20/7, comma, -5/7, comma, 10/7. Okay, so those are the components. That's W1. That's vector W1. W2 is equal to U minus W1. Now, I can either... So U minus W1 is U minus, you could also say this expression, right? But I calculated already. So this is equal to U minus this vector. U is equal to this vector, actually, right? So U, this is equal to U minus this vector. So I'm just doing one step at a time. So now if you subtract those vectors, then 2 minus 20/7 is 14/7 minus 20/7, which is -6/7, comma, -1 minus -5/7 is -1 plus 5/7. That's -7 plus 5/7, that's -2/7. Okay. Good. Okay. And then 10, and then 3 minus 10/7 is 21/7 minus 10/7, which is 11/7. So I'm just subtracting these two points, these two vectors to get this vector. Right? 2 minus this negative 1 minus that, 3 minus that, putting the components there, there, correspondingly. Okay, so that's the answer. So that's W1 and W2. So we found the vector component U long A and the vector component of U orthogonal to A. All right, so W2 is the vector component of U orthogonal to A. That's W1 and W2. Note, U dotted with U minus the projection of U onto A of projection of U onto A, right, like that. This is the same as U dotted with U minus W2, which is W1. This is equal to, so if you take U and you dot it with U minus the projection of U onto A, this is W2. So oh no, okay, so what I want is W1 dotted with this W1. Okay, so what I want is W1 dotted with W2. It's equal to W1 dotted with W2. Okay, so then, so this is W1 here. Is W2. So this is W2. And so this is U dotted with W2, which is W1, which is this guy, dotted with W2, which is that guy. So you dot product them. And when you work out the math, you get negative 120 divided by 7 plus 10. By 49, 7 times 7 is 49, plus 10 divided by 49, plus 110 divided by 49, and you get 0, because numbers are 49, you have negative 120 plus 10 plus 110, so this is 120 minus 120, 0. Okay, so W1 dotted with W2. We found W1 here, we found W2 here. What should happen is that they're orthogonal, meaning that the dot product is 0, and it works. Okay. New idea. The norm of the vector component of U along A is, so what we're thinking about now is the norm of the vector component of U along A. That's W1. Right, the norm of W1, I'm just writing that so you maybe can identify that with the W1 I wrote earlier. This, I'm talking about the projection of U along A, written that way, which is the norm of W1. That's equal to the norm of this expression. This is the expression for W1 we had earlier. U dotted with A over the norm of A squared times A. Well, if you take the norm of that, then the norms thing doesn't change. But you end up with the absolute value of this fraction times the norm of A. Okay. So we take the norm of a dot product is a number. If you take the norm of a number, it's the same as the absolute value. And same thing with the norm squared. The norm of A squared is a number. U dot of A is a number. U dot with A over the norm of A squared is a number, and the norm of a number is the norm of a constant multiple of a vector is the absolute value of that constant multiple times the norm of the vector. So when you talk about this expression, this norm is equal to the norm of a constant multiple k times a vector a. That's equal to the absolute value of k times the norm of a from earlier properties, from properties of norm that we talked about. Okay, so u dot with a over the norm of a squared is a number, it's a constant. So what you're really doing is you're saying that the norm of a constant multiple of a, and the norm of a constant multiple of a is the absolute value of k times the norm of a. So when you take the norm of this fraction, which is a real number times a, you want the absolute value of that number times the norm of a. Okay, but what's happening? You have the absolute value of the norm is the same as the norm. So what you really have is u dot with a times the norm of a over the norm of a squared. So this is equal to the norm, the absolute value of u dotted with a divided by the norm of a. Thus, the projection of u onto a, when you say projection of u onto a, the u is here and the a is the subscript, but when I'm typing it, I put the a first, so subscript, because that's what comes first in typing, proj subscript a u, that means projection of u onto a. So this is equal to, okay, so the projection of u onto a, right, that's w1. So, okay, so then, if you're looking at triangles, right? Okay, so I'm confused by talking about triangles. Okay, so now if you talk about this vector u, right? It's the projection of u onto a. You can think of as this w1, right? Where a is this, vector here, let's say, right? So w1, which is the projection of u onto a, you can think of this as two sides of a triangle. Okay, well, if you want to think about u dotted with a, if you want to talk about the norm of W1, which is the norm of the projection of U onto A, you could think of it in terms of if this is the angle between W1 and U, you could think of this as equaling to the norm of U times the absolute value of the cosine of theta. Why is that? Because cosine of theta is the ratio of the adjacent, cosine theta is equal to the ratio of the adjacent side over the hypotenuse. So if you take the ratio of the adjacent side over the hypotenuse, you get W1 over U. So, the norm of W1 is the length of W1, and the norm of U is the length of U. So really it's the norm of W1 divided by the norm of U. And so you're just saying the absolute value of it. So that way you're getting rid of the sign, plus or minus sign. Okay. So the absolute value of cosine of theta is equal to the norm of W1 divided by the norm of U. So that's why this is equal to the norm of U times the norm of W1 divided by norm of U. See how the norm of U cancels. That's the norm of W1. So the norm of u times the absolute value of cosine theta is the norm of u times the norm of w1 divided by the norm of u. That's w1. So that's what I'm saying there, that those two are equal. So I can express the norm of the projection of u onto a in this way. So the norm of the projection of u onto a is equal to the norm of w1. That's what it is. And it's the norm of u times the absolute value of cosine theta. Okay, so thus, the norm, I'm going to rewrite the formula I already wrote down first, and then say something else. Thus, the norm of the projection, I already wrote here. Thus, the norm of the projection of U onto A is equal to the norm of u times the absolute value of cosine theta, right? We already established that u dotted with a I came to the same conclusion my own way. Okay, so another way. So see if okay, so you have that. You have that, right? So also note that u dotted with a is equal to the norm of u times norm of a times cosine theta. Okay. So and that would mean okay, so u dotted with a is norm of u times norm of a times cosine theta. And so if you take the absolute value of, so the projection of u onto a, which is equal to the norm of w1, we said earlier, was equal to the absolute value of u dotted with a divided by norm of a. Okay, and so u dot, it's the absolute value of this, right? This is cosine theta, okay? So u dot with a is this one. So if you want is the absolute value of that expression. So you take the absolute value of this and divide it by the norm of A. See how the norm of A is cancel. The norm of A in the numerator cancels with the norm of A in the denominator, and you're left with the norm of Q times the absolute value of cosine theta. Okay, so you get that formula right there. You can also see it using triangles. Okay, so that's that. Just so conclusion here is that another way. Okay, so. Okay, so this is theorem 3.3.3, which is the theorem of Pythagoras in N space, in Rn. If U and V are orthogonal vectors in N space with the Euclidean inner product, that means the dot product as we have defined it, then if you take the norm of u plus v and you square it, this is equal to the norm of u squared plus the norm of b squared. Okay, so that's the theorem of Pythagoras in N space. Yeah, we are going to do a review, yeah, but it has to be later in the class because we have a lot of material to cover. Okay, so do you see what's on the screen? Is it X? Okay, I'm gonna X out this for a second. The thing froze. Don't know why it froze, but it did. Okay, so let me get back into it. Good. Okay, I got it back. The exam, remember, the exam is up to the end of chapter two, right? If now I'm going to check to make sure. Right, so test one is on topics one and two. Okay, so topics one and two, right? That's test one. It's on topics one and two, right? So I'm covering material that's gonna be in a later exam. Okay. Okay, so this is theorem 3.3.3. Okay, so this is theorem 3.3.4, part A. In R2, the distance P between points P naught of X naught comma Y naught and the line AX plus BY plus C equals zero is D. Okay, and so this is equal to in the numerator the absolute value of AX naught plus B Y naught plus C divided by the square root of A squared plus B squared. Okay, so in R2, the distance P, the distance D between the point P naught and that line is equal to this expression. Part B, in R3, in three space, the distance D between point P naught and X naught, comma Y naught, comma Z naught okay, between the point P naught and the plane, AX plus BY plus CZ plus D is equal to zero is, so D is that distance. And so here in R3, this is equal to the absolute value of AX naught plus B Y naught plus C Z naught plus D divided by the square root of A squared plus B squared plus C squared. Okay, so that's the formula. So it's simple because it's just a straightforward formula. So as long as you remember the formula, it can be simple. So this is example 7. Find the distance D between the point 1, comma, negative 4, comma, negative 3, and the plane 2x minus 3y plus 6z is equal to negative 1. Okay, so we want to find the distance D between that point and that plane. So the solution is just applying this formula above, okay? But first, let's rewrite. The equation of the plane as, so we're gonna write it as 2x minus 3y plus 6z plus 1 is equal to 0. Then D is equal to this fraction, where the numerator has the absolute value of, right, so we're in R3, so we want this formula, right? So we're gonna apply this formula here. And so we have equals, and so we want this expression. And so this is going to be where a is the coefficient of x. So a is 2, b is negative 3, c is equal to 6, and d is equal to 1. Okay. Also, you have the point x, y, z. You have x naught, y naught, z naught. X naught is the first coordinate of this point, which is 1. Y naught is the second coordinate of that point, which is -4. And z naught is the third coordinate of that point, which is -3. So x naught, y naught, z naught are the coordinates of this point, which you want to find the distance between the points and the plane. So x naught, y naught, z naught are the coordinates of that point. And the a, b, c, and d are from rewriting the equation as an equivalent equation where it's equal to 0. A is the coefficient of x, b is the coefficient of y, which is -3 is the coefficient of y. C is 6 and D is 1, the constant at the end. You just plug all those values in, and what you get is 2 times 1 plus -3 times -4 plus 6 times -3 plus 1. And it's divided by the square root of 2 squared plus -3 squared plus 6 squared. Okay? And so when you compute that, you get the absolute value of -3 divided by 7. And so that's equal to 3/7. Okay? And so the distance between that point and that plane is 3/7. Because I just plugged in the appropriate values of A, B, C, D, X naught, Y naught, and Z naught into that formula to get the distance. All right, and so that is distance. Okay, so example 8. Planes, x plus 2y minus 2z equals 3, and the plane 2x plus 4y minus 4z is equal to 7 are parallel because they're normals N1, which is the normal of the first one, is equal to 1 comma 2 comma -2, the coefficients of x, y, and z. The normals N1 and N2, and 2 is the coefficients of x, y, and z, 2, 4, -4. Their normals N1 and N2 are constant multiples of one another. That means the two normal vectors are parallel. Okay. So, fact, whenever two planes have parallel normal vectors, the two planes themselves are parallel. Okay, so you see that these two planes are parallel by saying that they're finding their normal vectors and finding that their normal vectors are parallel. Two vectors that are constant multiples of each other are parallel. Okay. To illustrate why that's true, if you have one normal plane here, and you look at its normal vector, say that's the normal vector, and you look at another plane, and you look at its normal vector, and it's a constant multiple of the other one, then it turns out these two planes are parallel. This vector is just a constant multiple of that one. It's a certain constant times u. There exists some constant times each one to get the other one. So these two vectors are parallel, and that means the planes perpendicular to those vectors are parallel. That's a normal vector. This is a normal vector. Okay, so that's like N1 and N2. So if N1 and N2 are parallel, then the planes P1 and P2 are parallel. Okay, so okay, so now you can ask, what is the distance between these parallel planes? So even though they're parallel, there could still be a distance between them. Okay. So so to find this distance between the planes, we select an arbitrary point on one plane and find its distance from the other plane. Right. So we have a formula for a distance between a point and a plane. If two planes are parallel, then every point on either plane is the same distance away from the other plane. It's a parallel, right? So if I choose one point here, it's just as far from this plane as another point on the parallel plane is to that same plane. And so just fix one point on one plane, find the distance from that point to the other plane. That's the distance of the entire first plane to the second plane. Okay, so choose, let's say, P naught to equal the point 3, 0, 0. Okay. So from earlier, we use the equation, the formula for D. So D is equal to now the distance between a plane, the distance between a plane and a point is equal to this, right? So now we have that. So this is where number x naught is the first coordinate of the point, which is 3. Y naught is the second coordinate of the point, which is 0. And z naught is the third coordinate, which is 0. So x naught, y naught, and z naught are y naught and z naught are 0. So these two terms will both become 0. We don't even need them. And then A, B, and C are the coefficients of the plane. We chose a point here, 3, 0, 0, because when x is 3, y is 0, and z is 0, you get 3 plus 0 minus 0 is 3. So this is the other plane. Its coefficients are A is 2, B is 4, C is negative 4. So A is 2, B is 4, and C equals negative 4. Right, and so remember that this equation of the line, note that the equation is equivalent to the equation, has the same solutions. It's equivalent to the equation, this equation, except I subtract 7 on both sides, so that doesn't change the solution set of the equation. But now you have a minus 7 on the left side and a 0 on the right side. Okay? Okay. So that new equation tells us that where I'm getting these values, A equals 2, B equals 4, C equals negative 4, and D is equal to negative 7. So I needed D equals 7 to negative 7. So D is equal to negative 7. So now I have the values of A, B, C, and D also. So now in the numerator, the absolute value of A, which is 2, times X naught, which is 3, but then it's plus 0 plus 0 because Y naught and Z naught are 0. So these terms go to 0. And then it's plus D, where D is negative 7, so that's minus 7. It's divided by A squared, which is 2 squared, plus B squared, which is 4 squared, plus C squared, which is negative 4 squared. And so that formula tells us that that's equal to 6 minus 7, negative 1, the absolute value of negative 1, divided by the square root of 2 squared, which is 4, plus 4 squared, which is 16, plus negative 4 squared, which is also 16. And so this is equal to 1 divided by the square root of 36, which is 6. So the distance is 1/6. Okay, so the distance between those two planes is 1/6. Because the distance between one point and the other plane is 1/6. So the conclusion is the distance between these two parallel planes is the same as the distance from one point on one plane to the other plane, which we found was, which we found is 1/6. Okay, so distance between these two parallel planes, because they're parallel, it's important, right? They're parallel, so we can do this. The distance between these two parallel planes is the same as distance from one point of one plane to the other plane, which we found is 1/6. So that's the end of 3.3. We'll cover a little bit more and then we can go to the review. So 3.4, this is theorem 3.4.1. Let L be the line in R2 or R3 that contains the point X naught and is parallel to the non-zero vector V. Then the equation of the line through the through X naught that is parallel to V is the following. X is equal to X naught plus TV. If X naught equals zero, then the line passes through the origin and its equation has the form X equals TV. So this is theorem 3.4.1. Let L be the line in R2 or R3 that contains the point X naught as parallel to the non-zero vector V. And the equation of a line through X naught as parallel to V is X equals X naught plus TV. So we illustrate that X equals X naught plus TV. That's our equation. Okay, so let's focus on the equation X equals X naught plus TV. Let's see, put that X equals X naught plus TV. So I'm gonna draw in the naught symbol here. X equals X naught plus TV, okay? So what this is saying is that, okay, so let's say you have your, let's do R2 so it's easier, but you can do this in R2 or R3 or Rn, okay? Let's say you have the vector X naught and the vector X naught goes to this point. So this is the vector X naught. Now, you want the line through the point X naught. You can think of points in R2 or you can think of points in R and I as the points or vectors, right? So this point is either a vector or a point. So you want a line through this point parallel to a vector called V. So let's think of a vector V. Let's say this is the vector V, the straight, okay? There's a vector V. I want a line through the point X naught and parallel to the vector V. So that line would just go through that point and would be parallel to V. So this line, okay? So this is the line represented by the equation X equals TV plus X naught. Okay, this is describing that line. If I take any fixed point on the line called X naught, then I travel along the vector V a certain number of times, I can get to any other point. I travel along the vector V once, starting X naught, if I go along V one time, I end up here. This would be T equals one. If I go twice along vector V, then I would go twice the distance, right? Let's say I go here, this would be another V, and then the point that I end up at would be when T equals two. It would be X naught, it would be X naught plus V one plus another V one. This point would be the point X naught plus two V one plus two V. See how that point is X naught plus two V? So how that corresponds with a certain value of T there. So for each different value of T, I would get a different point on the line and it would encompass the entire line. Every point on this line could be expressed as this initial vector V X naught plus some multiple of V. It doesn't have to be an integer. It could be half V, it could be three halves V, it could be pi V, any real number T times V, and you end up sweeping this entire line. So this line is expressed as the equation X, which represents the point on the line, that point X or vector X is equal to X naught plus TV. Okay, and if X naught is zero, then the vector you start at is the origin, which means that the line, if x naught was zero, would just be, in a sense, the same line, except instead of shifting it by x naught, you would just be parallel to this vector v. So if x naught was zero, then the equation would be x equals x naught, which is zero, plus tv. So it would just be tv like that. It would just be a multiple of this vector v because x naught was zero. So if x naught was zero, you would express the line as x equals tv, a multiple of that vector. Okay. Okay, so that's what that's saying. So that's theorem 3.4.1. Okay, so next is theorem 3.4.2. It says let W be the plane in 3 space that contains the point x naught and is parallel to the non-collinear vectors v1 and v2. Then an equation of the plane through x naught that is parallel to v to v1 and v2, parallel to both v1 and v2, is given by the equation x equals x naught plus t v1 plus t1 v1 plus t2 v2. If x naught is equal to zero, then the plane passes through the origin, and the equation has the form x is equal to t1 v1 plus t2 v2. Okay, so this is theorem 3.4.2. So this is similar to this, except instead of a line, instead of expressing a line, we're expressing a plane. Okay, so we want to express a plane. So if we're expressing a plane, we're going to be in 3 space, because a plane in 2 space would just be all of 2 space. Not interesting. So we'll talk about a plane in 3 space contains the point x naught and is parallel to the non-collinear vectors v1 and v2. We want to express this plane in this way. A point x on the plane is being equal to x naught plus t1 v1 plus t2 v2. So I'm going to go onto the whiteboard and draw a picture of this. So let's say we're living in 3 space. Okay, where this is x, y, and z, okay? So I want to express the equation x is equal to x naught plus t v1 plus t1 v1 plus t2 v2, okay? Well, let's say our vector x naught, I'm going to use different colors now to express this idea. Let's say x naught is here. This is x naught, blue vector. Okay, now v1 and v2 are defined as non-collinear vectors. Okay, so let's say v1, this vector v1, let's make v1, let's make this V1, okay, and I'm going to start it at the end point, the tip of X naught. Now let's say V2, so V2 is a non-collinear vector to V1. So let's make V2 like this. So it's obvious that V1 and V2 are non-collinear, meaning they can't be put in the same line. What we want is a plane that contains the point at the tip of X naught. That is parallel to both V1 and V2. Okay, so then you could just think of it as being the space that I'm going to use this pink color to describe it. The plane is in the sense this. It's going in all these directions. Left, right, up, and down. Okay? So this point here is on the plane. And you can now go either in the green direction or in the red direction. Direction V1 or in the red direction V1 or green direction V2. And you're on the plane. Okay? And so in a sense, that's the plane you want. Now, if X dot is zero, if this blue vector is zero, then instead of shifting or instead of going to this point that's not at the origin, if X dot is zero, you're just on the origin and this plane is on the origin, right? It doesn't mean it's parallel to the XY axis. These vectors V1 and V2 could be slanted. You could have a slanted plane that goes through the origin, right? But if the blue vector X dot is zero, it's a plane that goes through the origin. It could be slanted, it could be flat, it could be vertical, horizontal, angled, right? But it has to go through the origin, X not zero. Okay, and so that's what this theorem is saying. That's how you express a plane. If X not zero, then it's to the origin. Okay, X is a definition. So this definition says if X not, if X naught and V are vectors in N space, and if V does not equal zero, then the equation X equals X naught plus TV defines the line through X naught that is parallel to V. So if X on V are vectors in N space and V is not zero, then the equation X equals X naught plus TV defines a line through X naught that is parallel to V. Okay, what that's saying is that if you live in N space instead of 3 space or 2 space, and you take a vector X naught living in some n-dimensional space, because this is X naught living in some n-dimensional space, and you have a vector V also living in this n-dimensional space, then if you want a line that contains the point X naught and parallels this vector V, you would have a line just like before that goes through V, but perhaps the space you're living in is not 2 space, 3 space, 4 space, it could be any n space where this X naught has n components, V has n components. This line has points which have n components. It's just the same idea, right? This would be the origin. This would be the center, what you might think of as the center of your n space, the zero point. And so you go X naught from that zero point to some other point, then V is a vector that you start at that point, and the line goes through that vector V starting at that point. And that would be a line in n space that is parallel to V and contains the point X naught. Okay? Another definition. If X naught, V1, and V2 are vectors in N space, the review will start soon. Okay. And if V1 and V2 are not collinear, then the equation X equals X naught plus T1 V1 plus E2 V2. Defines the plane through X naught that is parallel to both V1 and V2. In the special case where X naught equals zero, the plane is said to pass through the origin. Okay, so just like before, we're expressing a point in a plane in n space as being x equals x naught plus t1 v1 plus t2 v2. So arbitrarily in n space, let's say your origin is here in n space, and you have a vector x naught, and you want to find a plane in arbitrary n space, then if you start at the origin and you have this blue vector x naught, then you have two vectors v1 and v2 that are non-collinear, right? Then in this arbitrary n space, you could just define your plane as being, containing the points at the tip of x naught and containing the vectors v1, v2, just going in all these directions. Okay? And so that would be an arbitrary plane in n space. So we're living in n space. Okay? Here we're also living in n space. Okay, we'll go to review very soon. Okay, so the last two equations. Okay, so these are equations. The last two equations. Okay, so this is equation 5, and this is equation 6. Okay, so the last two equations, 5 and 6, are called vector forms of line and plane in n space. If the vectors of these equations are expressed in terms of their components, and the corresponding components in either side are equated, the resulting equations are called parametric equations. Okay, so meaning you write this thing out, but instead of writing them as letters as vectors, you write all the components for each vector, and you add up the corresponding components, and you set each corresponding components equal to each other. So the first component on the left side equals the first component on the right, the second component on the left equals second component on the right. All those equations in n space, meaning n equations for each of the n components, the left side equals the right side of each of those n components, would be called parametric equations. Okay, so next class, after the next lesson, after the test, we'll continue with that. Okay, so with that, let's go to the review. Okay, so I'm willing to stay longer than 9:50 if you want more time for the review, okay? The video will be up online. So if you have to go, you can watch the video online on YouTube after it's done being posted, and you can see the rest of the review if you have to leave, okay? If you have to go sooner, you should ask the question before you have to leave at 9:50 maybe, okay? So questions about the review? Questions for the review now? Question? Preferably the practice test, right? Anyone have questions about the practice test? You said practice test 1, question 3, okay? So let's go over question 3, okay? So questions from the practice test. Okay, so the first question was question 3 in the beginning of the lesson. Okay, so after question 3, I'll go over question 2. Okay, so question 3 says, use the column row expansion of AB to express this product as a sum of matrices. Okay, so. So this would be the column row expansion, right? So the column row expansion. So then you just do C1 R1 plus C2 R2 plus C3 R3 plus dot, 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 right? And you get the answer. Okay, so okay, so here I wrote this out. Okay, so oh, I also had the answers on. Okay, so what you want to do is you want to express as the sum of five matrices, right? So the formula is that your matrix, so you have A, B, you can express A, B as equaling to C1, R1. C1, R1 plus C2, R2 plus C3, R3 plus C4, R4 plus C4, R4. How many rows and columns there? Yeah. Okay, so we have five. It's a 5x5 matrix. Okay, so we have 5x5. Okay, so plus C5, R5. Okay. So let's say, for instance, for the first one, C1 is the first column of A. Okay. So here for C1, you would have, that would be for C1. And then this will be for row one, the other matrix. So this would be R1. Okay. So the first column of matrix A is 4, 2, 6, 1, 7. 4, 2, 6, 1, 7. And now the first row of matrix. Well, okay, so then the first row of matrix B. It's saying my internet is unstable. 15832. So you have 15832. Now, when you multiply these together, you get. So this is a 5x1, right? This doesn't look like it. This is actually a 5x5 matrix when you product. This is a 5x1 matrix. And this next one is a 1x5 matrix. So if you follow the rules of multiplication matrices, the inner entries have to be the same, and the outer entries to find the size. So you get a 5x5 matrix here. So this is a 5x5 matrix where the first entry is here. Good. Okay, and so when you multiply these out, so for instance, if you take the first row times the first column, you get 4. Okay, 4, 20, 32. 4, 20. Good. Okay, so then first row times first column is just 4 times 7. The first row times second column is 4 times 5. The first row, third column is 4 times 32. And so what you do is you just find the product of this, and this would be the first matrix. So it'd be 2, 10, 16. I don't know if you want me to do all the work for this example, or you want me to keep going once you get it. So then you have 6, 30, 48, 18, 12, and then you have 1. 5, 8. Once you know and understand the formula, remember and understand the formula. This is an easy problem, right? So now it's 7, 35, 56, 21. I feel like it's just computations now if I keep spending time reviewing this. So this formula is just saying this was the first matrix, right? So you have a sum of a bunch of other matrices. So this would be a, let me just, 14. Okay, yeah, that's fine. Okay, good. So now this is your this matrix. This is this matrix. So you have a sum of proxy matrices, right? So now this is plus. Oh, that's fine. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Right? So so each time you just take the first column of matrix A times the first row of matrix B plus the second column of matrix A times the second row of matrix B plus the third column of matrix A times the third row of matrix B plus the fourth column of matrix A times the fourth row of matrix B plus the fifth column of matrix A times the fifth row of B. Then you add up those products and get the sum of products of 5x5 matrices. So this is going to also be another matrix. This is 5x5. And so then you get a 5x5 here. And you get 4 other 5x5 matrices and you add them up. So it's a lot of computations, but once you understand the formula, it's just straightforward calculating it. So then you end up with a sum of 5 matrices. You just have to remember the formula correctly and multiply and do all the calculations correct, right? So then the second, so you have your matrix A here. And you have your matrix B here. Okay. So so this is 4, 2, 6, 1, 7. This is 1, 5, 8, 3, 2. So very quickly, I'm just going to write in. What these matrices are. Okay, it lets me. Okay, good. Okay, so this is 4, 1, 8, -1, 3, 2, 1. -2, 2, 4, 6, 9, 3, 1, 0, 1, 0, -3, 7, 2, 7, 4, 5, 0, 8. And then this is 4, 3, 2, 0, 1. This is 7, 6, 5, 2, 6. This is 0, 0, 4, 18, 5. This is 2, 1, 6, 1, 4. Okay. So I wrote that in. That way we could refer to it. Okay, so so now this is the second column with A. So this is 1, 1, 9, 0, 4. This is the third column with A, which is 8, -2, 3, -3, 5. This is the fourth column with A, which is -1, 2, 1, 7, 0. And the fifth column of A is 3, 4, 0, 2, 8. The first row, second row of B is 4, 3, 2, 0, 1. The third row is 7, 6, 5, 2, 6. The fourth row is 0, 0, 4. 18, 5. Last row is 2, 1, 6, 1, 4. Okay, so now I've written it that way. Okay, and so now you just... Okay, so it's the sum of those 5. Now, so this is equal to the sum of these. I'm going to write this here. Okay. So now the next one is 1 times 4, 1 times 3, 2, 0, 1. Then 4, 3, 2, 0, 1. Then 36, 27, 18, 0, 9. The next one is all zeros because you're multiplying by 0. 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. And then the next one, 16, 12, 8, 0, 4. Let me check. This looks... Okay, good. Good, good, good. Just, it has this cross pattern here. It's zeros. Okay, so then the next one is 56, 48, 40, 16, 48. Next one is negative 14, negative 12, negative 10, negative 4, negative 12. Okay, 21, 18, 15, 6, 18, negative 3 times each one, negative 21, negative 18, negative 15, negative 6, negative 18, 35, 30, 25, 10, 30. Okay, so that's the third one. And then the last one, okay, so it's the fourth one, not the last one. 0, 0, what is this? Oh, 0, 0. So let me speed this up a little. So each of the first two are 0. So then that means that zeros here. All these have to be 0. Okay. Now, then this is negative 4, 8, 4, 28, 0. The last one is 0, so all these are zeros. Then this is negative 18. This is 36. This is 18. And this is 7 times 18, which is 70 plus 56, which is 126. And then this is negative 5, 10, 5, 35. And then the last one is multiplying everything. So you have 6, 3, 18, 3, 12, 8, 4, 24, 4, 16. This is everything zeros here. 6, 3, 18. It's the same as the first row. 3, 12, 16, 8, 48. 8, 32. Let me check that 126 in the second plus matrix. 126. Yep, there's a 126 there. Good. 126, 35. Okay, 126, 35. 126, good. Okay, so that's the answer, and that's how you get it. Does that make sense? So you'll have plenty of time to take the test. So I'm not going to say how computational it is, but it will be... The test you'll have plenty of time to take the exam, okay? you should be able to finish the exam in the time I give. That's what I'll say. Okay. So all the topics you should study for are on the syllabus. So topic one and topic two for test one. Topic one, systems of linear equation matrices, sections 1.1 through 1.9. And topic two, 2.1 to 2.3. Okay, everything else is on the other exams. Also, if you go to the review sheets, right, so this is the practice test. So that's good to look at too. There's also the review sheet, which I'm going to have to bring up now. Okay. Bring up the review sheets. So here's the review sheet, right? So these are all the sections. Just look at the review sheet. You have chapter one stuff here, chapter two problems here. You should know these problems and be able to answer the questions on the practice test. Okay. Also, there's a question about number two on the review, right? So number two on the review sheet, on the practice, number two, use parametric equations to describe the solution set of the linear system. Okay, so let's describe the solution set of this linear system using parametric equations. So for that, I'm going to go to the whiteboard. Okay, so I think you can see the whiteboard now, right? You should be able to see, you should be looking at the whiteboard at this present moment. Okay, so I'm going to copy down the equations here on the whiteboard. So you have x plus 6y plus 2z. You have the equations in front of you. Minus 5w equals 0. You have negative x minus 6y minus z minus 3w equals 0. You have 2x plus 12y plus 5z minus 18w is equal to 0. Express this as a matrix. Think of it, the coefficient matrix. 1, 6, 2, negative 5. Negative 1, negative 6, negative 1, negative 3, 2, 12, 5, negative 18, right? Okay, so, and then, you know, on the right side, you can think of the augmented matrix for that linear system. So you have that, okay? So the goal is to get this matrix in reduced row echelon form, okay? So the goal is get matrix, get augmented matrix to reduce row echelon form. Okay. Then find parametric equations expressing the solution set after. Okay. Okay, so first we want to get this matrix to reduce row echelon form. So to do that, okay, we have as our next step. So you have the first row, 1, 6, 2, negative 5, and then 0. Let me end this bracket early. Okay, so now I'm going to add the first row to the second row, right? If you look here, you have your first column, and the goal is to get the topmost entry of the leftmost non-zero column to be 1. That already happened. But we also want all the entries below it to be 0. So you want these entries to be 0. So you have to add suitable multiples of the first row to the other rows to make them 0. So if you add the first row to the second, you end up with a 0 here. And so then you have a 0 here, you have a 1 here, and you have a negative 8 here, and you have a 0 here.
If you add two, can you repeat again?
Sorry?
Can you repeat that?
Sure. Okay, so in the beginning, you take the first leftmost non-zero column. Right, that's the blue column here. And the goal is to get the topmost entry to be non-zero entry, and then to be a 1. So that's all done already. So now what you need is the red entries below it to all be 0. So in order for all the red entries to be 0, you have to add suitable multiples of the top row containing that 1 to each bottom row so that all those entries below it become 0. So you have to add 1 times the first row to the second to make the second entry 0. Then you have to add negative 2 times the first row to the third to get the 2 to be 0. So if you do that, you get a 0 here. So then if you get that, you get a 0 here. And then you get a 0 here. And then you get a 1 here. And then you get a negative 8 here and still 0 here. The zeros, there'll be zeros on the right-hand side, no matter what you do, because adding constant multiples of 0 to 0 always gives you 0. Now, then when you keep going, so now this entry, well, everything below it is 0. And so according to Gauss-Jordan elimination, you now, in a sense, don't, you now, in a sense, forget about this top row. Now look at the next row. So now in the next row, you look at the leftmost non-zero column of the submatrix, which is this guy. Now the goal is to get the topmost entry to be non-zero and then to be 1. That's good. But the entry below it is non-zero. You want to get that entry to be 0. So now, remember the top row you're ignoring because you passed the step where you care about the top row for now in the forward phase of Gauss-Jordan elimination. So now the top row, you're now, don't think about it. And now you're dealing with the submatrix after you remove it, okay? It's still there in the matrix, but you just don't care about it in, when you're applying this method. So now you have this, and now you add -1 times this row to the other row. And so then you end up with a 0 here, and then a 0 here, and a 0 here. So what I did was I took -1 times the top row of the submatrix and added it to the second row of the submatrix. So that way, this red entry below it became a 0. When I did that, all the entries below this one is now 0, which means I've now satisfied the forward phase for this row. And now I can think about removing it. But actually, first, let me think about, is this matrix now in row echelon form? It is. It's now in row echelon form. This matrix is in row echelon form. Check. Once your matrix is in row echelon form, you can now go to step 6 of Gauss-Jordan elimination, which is the backwards phase, which means you're starting from the bottom. You want to move upward so that way you have all 0 entries above each leading 1. So first, let me rewrite this matrix. Okay. So now... So now if you, the bottom row has all 0s. So you just move up to the next row. What you want is a leading 1. So you have a leading 1 here. So, but this leading 1, we are now looking at this column starting from the bottom up. And we want all the entries. I want all the entries above this to be non-zero. And so that entry is this guy here. So I need to add -2 times the second row to the third row to make that entry a 0. And so now I have 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. I have 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, -8, 0. And I add -2 times that row to one above it. I have 1, 6, 0, 11, 0. I took, -2 times the second row and add it to the first row to get rid of the 2. And so if you take -2 times -8, that's 16. 16 plus -5 is 11, right? And then 0 plus 0 is 0. So you have this now. So now this entry here is now become a 0. But if you move up to the next leading 1 here, there's nothing above it. And so you're good. So now this matrix is now in reduced row echelon form. I'm just breaking a 0 here still. I'm just writing it clear. That's a 0. Okay, so now this matrix is now in reduced row echelon form. You know that because one, every non-zero entry has a leading 1. Property 1 is good. Every non-zero entry has a leading 1. All the 0 rows are grouped at the bottom. Every 2 consecutive rows of leading 1, the leading 1 below it is further to the right than the leading 1 above it. And 4, every column with the leading 1 has zeros above it, has zeros everywhere else, okay? So every column with the leading 1, only columns 1 and 3 have a leading 1, and every other entry is 0. So all 4 properties of a matrix in reduced row echelon form is satisfied with this matrix. So we got the matrix to reduce row echelon form first. We've achieved that. The next is then find parametric equations expressing the solution of it. So maybe, can I paste this here? Okay, so then that's the matrix, right? So so now I need to, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna rewrite this matrix on the next page. So 1, 6, 0, 11, 0. 1, 1611 0 0 1611 0 0 1 6 0 11 0 1 6 0 11 0 0 0 1 -8 0 0 0 1 -8 0 0 0 0 0 Okay, 0 0 1 -8 0 0 0 1 -8 0 Okay, and then 1 6 0 11 0 Okay, so this is your matrix in reduced Rochelle form. So we want parametric equations described by this. So your okay, so if you can stay, you can stay. If you can't, this video will be up on YouTube once I'm able to download onto it. Okay, and you'll be able to watch the rest of you missed on there. Okay, so because it's already past 9:50. So this represents a leading variable, and so does this. Okay, so x1, this corresponds with x1, it's a leading variable. This corresponds with x3, it's also a leading variable. So x1 and x3 are leading variables because they correspond with leading ones in your matrix in reduced Rochelle form. The other variables, any variable that is not a leading variable is not a leading variable. It's a non-leading variable. The name doesn't even matter. A free variable. It's called a free variable. Leading variables, free variables. Okay, so x2, x4 are free variables. X2, x4 are free variables. Okay, so when you make parametric equations, you want to express, so you assign each free variable its own parameter. Okay, first you do that. Then you express each leading variable in terms of those parameters / in terms of only free variables. Okay. So so the first the equations here are x1 plus 6x2 plus 11x4 is equal to 0, and x3 minus 8x4 is equal to 0. Now notice that I can now express, this implies that x1 is equal to negative 6x2 minus 11x4, because we did the step first to get this matrix in reduced Rochelle form. I can now express each leading variable in terms of only free variables. So notice how x1, x3 are described using only x2 and x4, which are free variables. And so I'm going to assign x2 equaling to the variable s, and x4 I'm going to assign equal to, the parameter t. So that means x1 is equal to negative 6s minus 11t. And x3 is equal to 8t. So I've now expressed x1 and x3 using only these parameters and not using any other anything else in the parameters numbers, right? So now I have x1, x3 described that way. X2 and x4 are assigned parameters, so they're already expressed using only parameters. And so the final solution is that x1 is equal to negative 6s minus 11t. X2 is a simple answer. It's s. It's the parameter you assigned it. X3 is equal to 8t. And x4 is another simple answer. It's equal to the parameter you assigned it, which is t. Sometimes confuse people what x2 and x4 are. They're just the variables you assigned to them. So this is the final answer. These are, well, this is the solution set described in terms of parametric equation. The components of x1, x2, x3, x4. Okay, that's the answer. Okay, so that's the answer to number two. So this is number two continued. Okay, this is number two. Okay, so I give around 45 minutes, at least 45 minutes, maybe a little more. So, okay, let me check that. Yeah, 45 minutes. Yeah, 45 minutes. Okay, so it's 45 minutes. Okay, so it'll be on Zoom during class, right? And so I already explained all of that. Okay, and so you'll be handing in by email after the exam is over. Okay, let's start with emails and then I might do something else in the future. Okay, so question four. Evaluate the determinant. Okay, so question four, you can see that on the screen and you can't see it on the screen. Okay, so question four is evaluate the determinant. Good. Okay, so this will be faster than that other problem. The other two were much longer. So the exam will be five questions and 1 hour long. Okay. So now the next slide, we're going to find the determinant of this matrix. 5, negative 2, 1, 0, 3, negative 1, 2, 0, 7. Okay, so we're finding the determinant of this matrix. So let's make our lives easier and let's use the cofactor expansion along the first column since it contains a 0, right? I like the 0 here. That makes it easier. So we're going to find the cofactor expansion along the first column. And keep in mind the checkerboard pattern of pluses and minuses. Plus, minus, plus. That's a plus sign. Minus, plus, minus. Plus, minus, plus. And so we're going along the first column in our cofactor expansion. And so there'll be plus, minus, plus. So it's positive 5 times the determinant of the submatrix determined by removing the first row and first column. So when you're going along the when you have this first entry, 5, the submatrix is getting rid of the row and column that entry is in. And so that entry is 3, negative 1, 0, 7. That's the submatrix, right? 3, negative 1, 0, 7. So 3, negative 1, 0, 7. Now you subtract, this is a minus sign, 0 times a submatrix. And I guess I'll just add this in, though you don't have to do this calculation. If you're now looking here, you move the row and column it's in, and the submatrix is negative 2, 1, 0, 7, negative 2, 1, 0, 7. And so it's negative 2, 1, 0, 7. And then there's a plus sign. See that in the checkerboard pattern. Now it's a plus 2 times, now you remove the row and column that the 2 is in, and the submatrix is negative 2, 1, 3, negative 1. So you get negative 2, 1, negative 2, 1, 3, negative 1. And so this is equal to 5 times. Now remember, when you find the determinant, It's just this times this minus that times that. So that's 21 minus 0, which is 21. So the term of that is 21. Minus 0 times, it doesn't matter what this product is because you're multiplying by 0. But just for completeness, you have negative 14 minus 0, which is negative 14. And then plus 2 times, if this is 0 and you want to just cross something out because of it, that's fine by me. Now, this times this minus this times this. So it's 2 minus 3, which is negative 1. Which is negative 1. So 2 minus 3 is negative 1. Negative 2 times negative 1 is 2. 2 minus 3 is negative 1. So then this is equal to 105. 105 plus 0 minus negative is positive. Positive 0 plus 0 minus 2. And so that equals 103. And that's the answer. Okay. Nice and easy, right? That's not too bad. Other questions? So I went over question 4. Question 5. Is that a question I went over? Find the inverse of the following matrix. Okay, fantastic. Okay, so let's find the inverse of that matrix. So the inverse. Okay, so we got the harder working ones out of the way first, which I guess is good.
Professor, I think the 5, I was answering one of your questions, not asking for the number 5. So
if you're gonna I went over 2, 3, and 4. I'll just go over 5. So if you take the inverse of this matrix, unless you don't want, nobody wants me to go over it. If to take the inverse of this matrix, right? So you can do the matrix. Let's do it that way. We're going to find the inverse, but we're going to do it using the inversion method, this method, right? So you're going to, on the left side, you have your matrix. On the right side, you have the identity. And you want to get the left side in reduced echelon. You want to get the left side to be the identity, and the right side will be the inverse. So you switch the first and second rows. So if you switch the first and second rows, you get 1, negative 4, negative 2, 0, 1, 0, 0, negative 3, negative 2, 1, 0, 0. And then you have negative 3, 4, 1, 0, 0, 1. And so then I switch the first and second rows. So I have the first column here. I have the top entry in that column as being a 1 already. It's not 0, it's a 1. I add 3 times the first row to the third row. And so now this is equal to 1, negative 4, negative 2, 0, 1, 0. This is fine. The second row is fine right now. And then you have 3 times the first row add to the third row. And you have negative 8 here. And you have negative 5 here. And then 3 times it. 3 times. 3 times it. Good. Okay, so now you have that. Okay, so now that's the first column. That in the top entry is now 1, right? So now that we're done with that, you now stop looking at, it's still there, but you just stop thinking about it. And now you look at the submatrix afterwards. You take the leftmost non-zero column, which is that. You want the topmost entry to be non-zero, which it is, but now you need to be a 1. So you multiply by negative 1/3 that row. So that way that becomes a 1. And so now you have a 1, negative 4, negative 2, 0, 1, 0. You have 0, 1, multiplying by negative 1/3, you get 2/3 here. You have negative 1/3, so negative 1/3, 0, 0. And then I now have this as a 1. I want to make this bottom entry, I want to make this entry a 0. So let me add 8 times that second row, this row to the one below it. Remember, we don't care about this row right now. So I want to take this entry here, this new entry, and I want to add it 8 times that row to the bottom row to get rid of that negative 8 below it. So I get 0, 0, 8 times 2/3 is 16/3, 16/3 plus negative 5 is 1/3, 16/3 plus negative 15/3 is 1/3. And so then you have negative 8/3 here. Eight times that was that. 8 times this plus this is 3. And 8 times this plus this is 1. So now you have that. So now the goal was to get all the entries below this 1 here to be a 0, which it is. And so now that I'm done with that, it's still not in form. Yeah?
Can you please write the operations on the top? So it's going to be confusing right now.
Okay, so what I did was I switched rows 1 and 2 here. Okay, does that make sense?
Yes, Professor.
Okay, so I switched rows 1 and 2 here, and that's what that happened. Then afterwards, I added negative 3 times row 1, and I added it to row 3. Okay, not negative 3, 3 times row 1. I added that. 3 times row 1, I added it to row 3, and then that got rid of that. So then after that, I then multiplied the second row by negative 1/3 times the second row. And so I got that. Then I took 8 times row 1, row 2. Though I'm not thinking of the sub, I'm calling R2 the second row of the original matrix. I took 8 times row 2 after I did the top, after I did negative 1/3 R2. I then took 8 times row 2 and added it to row 3. Okay. To get this. So now I still have, after I'm done with those two rows, so hopefully that explains it. So then I now have that as a 1/3. I need that to be a 1. So I multiply the third row. So I'm going to multiply the third row by 3. So it's going to be 3R3, meaning I'm multiplying the third row by 3. So when I multiply the third row by 3, the first row is 1, negative 4, negative 2, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 2/3. Unfortunately, I'm doing all this just to multiply something by 3. Negative 1/3, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, negative 8, 9, 3. Okay. I now multiply the third row by 3. And I get that. So now what happened is that the matrix is in row echelon form now. So now that the matrix is in row echelon form, I'm now happy because now I can go to step 6. I can now go to step 6. There's a smiley face. I'm happy because step 5 is done. And so now I can start thinking about step 6, which is if you starting from the bottom, what I want is the leading one in the bottom row. I want all the entries above it to be a 0. So I have to add suitable multiples of the bottom row to the rows above it to make them zeros. So then I do that. So let's do that here. So this is 0. I'm going to write smaller. 0, 0, 1, negative 8, 9, 3. Negative 2/3 times the third row. Negative 2/3 times R3. It's a 3. Negative 2/3 times R3 and add it to R2. And so then you have a 0, 1, 0, negative 2/3. So that's 16/3 plus negative 1/3. That's 15/3, which is 5. So that's 5. So negative 2/3 times 9 is negative 18/3, which is negative 6. Negative 6 plus 0 is 6. Negative 2/3. Times 3 is negative 2. Negative 2 plus 0 is negative 2. Then 2 times R3, I add it to R1. So that way the negative 2 goes away. So then 2 times, so 1, negative 4, that doesn't change. 2 times, that becomes a 0. And then 2 times R3. 2 times R3 and we add to R1. That's this new bottom R3. So that's the same. Okay, so negative 16 plus 0 is negative 16. 18 plus 1 is 19. And 6 plus 0 is 6. So now I'm done with this leading one row. That's good. So now I move to the next leading one here. And now I want the entry, all the entries above it to be zero. So that one is not zero. So that's the problem. So now these operations will make that negative four zero. And then it'll be, we'll be done. So you have 0, 0, 1, -8, 9, 3. We're only adding upward. And so the fact that I'm working in the second row means that if I'm only adding upward, the third and second rows are going to be unaffected by my operations. So the bottom two rows are the same, only the top row will change. I'm going to add 4 times R2. I take 4 times R2 and add it to R1. So the effect changes R1, the thing on the right. So this is going to stay a 1, then this is going to become a 0, and then this is going to be still a 0. 4 times 5 is 20, 20 plus negative 6 is 4. 4 times 6 is 24, 24 plus 19 is 43. And then 4 times negative 8 plus 6, 4 times negative 2 is negative 8, negative 8 plus 6 is negative 2. Now let me check something, let me make sure. Okay, there's some calculation error I made. Hold on, 5, negative 6, negative 2. Okay, so if you switch the first and second rows, you have this, and then 2, negative 3, negative 2, 1, 0, 0. 3R1 plus R3, 0, negative 8, negative 5. Good. Next is negative 1/3 R2. It's 1, 2/3, negative 1/3, good. 8 R2 plus R3, 16/3, 1/3, negative 8/3. Negative 8/3 plus 0, negative 8/3. 0 plus 3. That's good. 3R3. 1, negative 8, 9, 3. 2R3. Negative 2/3 R3 plus R2. Negative 2/3. 16/3, 15/3 is 5. Negative 18/3 is negative 6. It's a negative 6 there. This is a negative 6. And then okay, so this is fine. Okay, good. So then good. Okay. And then 2R3 plus R1. -4, 0, -16, 19, 6. Okay, so now it's 4R2 plus R1. So now those stay this. This is still a -6. Now it's 4R2 plus R1. So 4. Now this is a -6. So then, negative 24 plus 19 is negative 5. And then negative 8 plus 2 is negative 2. So 4, 5, negative 2. So I think this is good now. 4, 5, negative 2, negative 2, 5, negative 6, negative 2, negative 8. Very good. That's fine. That's now, this is the answer. This is it. So now this is the matrix. This is A inverse. By the inversion algorithm, we now have that that's A inverse. Okay? That's using the inversion algorithm. Okay? So I went over 2, 3, 4, and 5. Okay? Any other questions? Okay, so I put the operations, right? Did that help? The double arrow, R1, double arrow, R2, means that I switch the two rows, right? Yeah, so I have office hour tomorrow. Yep, see? So usual time. And you can come to that office hour. If you go on Blackboard and you go to Blackboard Collaborate Ultra, right? I have all the office hours right there. So if you need more help, feel free to come to office hour tomorrow and I'll help you with that, okay? So I went over a lot. Any more questions? We can end here if there are no more questions. You just go onto the website on the menu bar on the left-hand side. There's Blackboard Collaborate Ultra. You click that, and then there's a schedule of all upcoming, all future office hours. And so you just click that. There's no Zoom link. It's not on Zoom. It's not a Zoom link. You click on that. It opens, and I'm there at that time. Okay? You're welcome. You can join the room up to 15 minutes before it starts, but I might not be there before it starts. I'm there at the time it starts. Okay. So if you get there early, I get there on time, but I allow you to join the meeting early in case you have internet things or you want to make sure you can get in. Okay. You're welcome. Okay. So we covered all that. Okay. So I hope that helps you study. And don't forget the test is on Tuesday next class at the start of class. It'll be on Zoom during class, okay? Good night, everyone. All right. I'm going to save the PDF. So the PDF and the notes will be on Blackboard, and I'm going to upload the video onto YouTube, so the video will be on YouTube also, okay? So good night, everyone. See all of you soon.
All right, good night, Professor. Thank you.
Good night. You're welcome.